have a message for you.
I have a message for you.
From whom?
Now, I'm not at liberty to reveal the nature of my work. This secrecy pains me from time to time. Any bureaucracy that functions in secret inevitably lends itself to corruption. But these rules I have pledged to uphold. I believe a pledge is sacred.
Speaking as a man and a fellow employee of the federal government, so do I.
Well, I may reveal this much. Among my many tasks is the maintenance of deep space monitors aimed at galaxies beyond our own. We routinely receive various communications, space garbage to decode and examine. They look something like this. It's radio waves and gibberish, Agent Cooper. Till Thursday night. Friday morning, to be exact. Row after row of gibberish, and all of a sudden...
The instantaneous rate of change.
Instantaneous rate of change? That's the rate of change at a single point, at a single instant. And we know that to be the derivative at that point.
Derivative of f?
It just means the derivative of f.
The instantaneous rate of change.
When we take an instantaneous rate of change.
Now that instantaneous rate of change is going to give us a little more precision.
Later in the morning.
Instantaneous rate of change.
It gives you the rate of change at any instant, the instantaneous rate of change.
Now, the slope of a tangent line is called an instantaneous rate of change because it represents how fast something is changing at a single point or at a point in time, not between two different points or two different points in time.
What that instantaneous rate of change is, what does that even mean?
So this is the definition of the derivative.
Why did you bring this to me?
Because...
Remember, a derivative, you can think of that as an instantaneous rate of change, as opposed to an average rate of change.
My God.
The derivative is the instantaneous rate of change. Let's just work through some examples of this idea. Let's first suppose that our function is a function of time, and it gives the position of some object. So P of t tells you where the object is. Then the rate of change of that position, the derivative, P prime of t, is the velocity of the object. That's the speed with direction taken into account. So P prime of t is the velocity at time t. Next example. Let's suppose our function, which is named dollar sign of t, tells us the number of dollars in a bank account at time t. Well, then the derivative is telling us the rate of change of that bank account. In other words, it's telling us how fast the account is making or losing money at time t. Next example, suppose that v of t, again a function of time, is the number of folks who are infected with the coronavirus at time t. The derivative of that function, v prime of t, is telling us the rate of the spread of infection at time t. In other words, it's telling us, for each unit of time that goes by, how many new people are infected. We don't always have to have a function of time. These last two examples involve variables that are not time. So in the first example, x will be the number of gallons of gas that I'm going to consume in my car, and the function m of x will be the number of miles driven using that x gallons of gas. What's the derivative of this function, m prime of x? It's telling us the rate of miles driven for every additional gallon of gas you put in the car. In other words, it's the miles per gallon, the mpg of the vehicle, after you've used x gallons of gas. Now, usually that doesn't depend on x, right? We think of a car as having a single miles per gallon, a standard rate. And that's fine. This could be a constant function of x. Right? So as I'm consuming x gallons of gas, I go some number of miles, and that function is increasing at a constant rate. That's the miles per gallon, the mpg of the vehicle. That's how fast I'm adding new miles as I consume more gallons. Okay, in the last example, x will be the number of cups of coffee that I drink, and I of x will be my intelligence level after drinking those x cups of coffee. Now, of course, measuring intelligence level is kind of silly. This isn't actually some function valued in numbers, but let's just pretend that it is. What would be its derivative, I prime of x? That would tell us how much my intelligence is increasing, or possibly decreasing, for each cup of coffee that I drink. The rate of increase of intelligence per cup of coffee. Let's see an example of this idea in action. And I want to start with an example where the input variable x is not time. So we're going to consider a square whose side length is the variable x. Here's that square. Each of its sides has length x. Now as x grows larger, the square is going to expand. And my question is, what is the rate of expansion of the area of the square at the moment when the side length of the square is 3 meters? So just to have a picture of what's going on, here's the case where x is equal to 1, a 1 meter by 1 meter square. That's, we're going to draw that kind of small. And then as x increases, we can have a square with side length 2, and then x is again increasing, and here we have a square with side length 3, and then the square continues to expand. Here it has side length 4. So that's the rough idea. As x grows larger, the square is getting larger, and we want to know at this precise instant, when the side lengths are 3 meters, how fast is it accumulating area as x changes? So to answer this question, we need to first find a formula for the area. The area of the square as a function of x, we'll call that capital A of x, capital A standing for area. What is the area of a square? Well, if it's x by x meters, that area is given by x squared. In fact, that's why we call this function the squaring function, because it's telling us the area of a square. Goes back to those geometric roots. So that's a function whose input is the side length and whose output is the area. To find this rate of expansion, let's find the derivative of this function. And to do that, I'm again going to use the definition of the derivative. So here we have a prime of x. What is that? By definition, that's the limit as h goes to 0 of a of x plus h minus a of x, all divided by h. Let's plug in and evaluate the limit. So, a of x plus h, that's x plus h squared. A of x, that's just x squared. And we're dividing by h. Continuing onward. Let's expand and do the algebra. That's what we get for the numerator, x squared plus 2xh plus h squared minus x squared. And again, we're dividing by h. Moving onward. What's going to happen in the next step? Let's see, we have an x squared and a minus x squared. Those are canceling. So in this next step, let's factor out an h. We'll be left with 2x plus h upstairs, and we still have h downstairs. We're finally in the position where we can cancel the h's. Remember, that's what we're always trying to do in these limit calculations of the derivative. And then as h goes to 0, we're just left with the term 2x. Remember, you're letting h go to 0, not x. So the result is a function, the derivative of a, and if you input some x value, like 3, it's telling you the rate of expansion of the square when the side length x is 3. So the answer to our question is given by plugging in that particular side length 3 into the derivative function. The derivative function is 2x, so if we plug in 3, we'll end up with 6. So that's telling us exactly the rate of expansion of the square. This says that the square adds on 6 meters squared of area per unit increase in the side length x at the particular value x equals 3. When the side length is 3, the square is adding on 6 meters squared of area per unit increase in x. Now notice that that rate is per increase in x. It's not the speed as a function of time, because our function a of x was not a function of time, it was a function of x. So it's telling us the rate of increase per unit increase in side length. Okay, I have another question about the square. What is the rate of expansion not of the area, but of the perimeter of the square when the side lengths are at 3 meters? So it's the same process, but we're going to use a different function. The side lengths here on the square are all x. The square is expanding as x is growing. Each of those sides has length x. So let's construct a perimeter function. Let's call it capital P of x. So x, the side length, is the input, and then capital P of x is the output. That's telling us the perimeter. What's the perimeter of this square? Perimeter just means the length around the outside, right? So as we go around, we have x plus x plus x plus x. That's 4x. The perimeter of the square is given by 4x. We want to know the rate of increase of that perimeter. Now at this point, we could appeal to the fact that this function, 4x, is a line, and its slope is 4, so the derivative has got to be 4. And at this point, I think that we've done enough of these calculations that you can see that that's what's going to happen. But I'm still going to do the calculation just to show you that that is the case, because it's always good to practice these limit calculations for the derivative. So there we have the definition of the derivative. And we're going to evaluate the limit. We expect to get 4. Let's see, if we plug in x plus h into our function, we'll end up with 4 times x plus h. And if we plug in just x into our function, we'll end up with 4x. So the subtraction there in the numerator, in the definition of the derivative, is 4 times x plus h minus 4x. Okay. Now we do the algebra. Let's multiply everything out. We end up with 4x plus 4h minus 4x. Very good. So the 4x and the minus 4x cancel, and we're left with the limit of 4h over h. Fantastic. H on top and h on the bottom, that common term, now cancels, and so we're looking at just the number 4, its limit as h approaches 0 is just 4. It doesn't change. So in fact, we found that the derivative of this function is 4, just as we expected. Anytime you have a line function, its derivative is just going to be a constant function telling you the slope of that line. In particular, if we plug in, say, 3, that's what the question was about, we'll get 4. So the square is adding 4 meters of perimeter for every meter that we add to x. That's one way to say what this rate of change is. It's the rate of change of how fast, how much the parameter is increasing for every unit increase in the x variable. So in other words, for every meter that we add on to the square, we get 4 new meters of perimeter. And you know, that makes sense if you think about the square, right? If x increases by 1, the overall perimeter is increasing by 1 in each of the 4 sides. So it's a total increase of 4. And that didn't really depend on 3. The question was about 3, but that's true actually for any x value. So in fact, we can answer a much more general question. This is the rate of increase of the perimeter for any side length. You're always adding 4 meters to the perimeter for each unit that you increase the side length x.
In the next example, we're at a drag race. We're watching some race cars go real fast. So let's suppose that we have some particular race car in the race. There it is. And we're going to let the position of that race car at time t, measured in seconds, be given by this function p of t, which is equal to 20t squared plus 3t. Now the output of that function, the position, is given in feet from the starting line. So as you can see in my picture, p of t is this distance from the start to wherever the race car is at time t. And now the race car zooms along from the start over to the finish line. And let's suppose that the race is over in 5 seconds. It just takes 5 seconds for the race car to get from the start to the finish. Okay, I got 2 questions about this situation. First of all, how far is it from the starting line to the finish line? What's the total distance traveled by the car? All right, so to get a handle on this, let's think about this function p of t. What happens if we plug in, for starters, p equals 0? Remember, the function was 20t squared plus 3t. So I'll just plug in t equals 0 here so that we can get started. And we got zeros everywhere, and so the initial position here is 0. At time 0, we're 0 feet from the starting line. That doesn't actually help us answer our question, but it's just kind of a reality check. I'm just observing that at the start of the race, we're at the starting line, right? Okay, so what's the relevant value at the end of the race? Well, the race took 5 seconds, so we should find the position when t is equal to 5. So now I'm going to plug in 5 into this function. So everywhere in the formula for p of t, I'm going to insert t equals 5. We get 20 times 5 squared plus 3 times 5. What's that? Well, that's 25 times 20. And 25 goes into 100 4 times. And 20 is 4 times 5. So you get to do that 25 into 100 5 times. So that'll be 500 plus 15, which is 515. So it's 515 feet from the starting line at the end of the race. That's at time t equals 5. All right, so that's the answer. Let's just write it down in a complete way. This is the end of the race. So the total change in position from start to finish is precisely 515 feet. Awesome. So that was the first question, and you know, we didn't really need calculus. There was no derivative or anything, right? We just plugged in some t values into our function. This is the sort of problem that we could solve in pre-calculus. This doesn't need calculus methods. But the second question is a little bit more complicated. The second question is, how fast is the race car going at the end of the race when it crosses the finish line? How fast is the race car going at the end of the race? That car is accelerating throughout the race. It's going faster and faster and faster, and we want to know how fast is it going at the end. Okay, so to answer that, we do need to take the derivative. That's because the velocity is the rate of change of position. So the velocity of the car at time t, the rate of change of position, is precisely the derivative of the function p of t. That velocity is p prime of t. And what is that derivative? Well, once again, I'm going to compute it using the limit definition. Now, I know that you might be getting kind of sick of this. I hear you. But I think it's important before we start doing all of the various tricks that we'll have to compute derivatives to keep on practicing with the limit definition just a little bit more. So I'm going to compute this derivative using the limit definition. How do I do that? I got to plug t plus h and t into my function. Here we go. So if I plug in t plus h into the function, I get that expression. That's because the function is 20t squared plus 3t. So if I plug in t plus h, I'll get that right there. And then I need to subtract off just the function at time t. There it is. That's the function at time t. And we're dividing by h. So to recap, the velocity is the derivative of the position function. It's the rate of change of position. The derivative, by definition, is given by this limit, and I just plugged in for t plus h and t in that limit. And now we're going to evaluate. Here we go. I'm going to do all the algebra. I got to explain the t plus h squared and then multiply by 20. So we'll have 20t squared plus 40th plus 20h squared plus 3t plus 3h. Those are all the terms that we get from the first big set of parentheses. And then we're subtracting off 20t squared, and we're also subtracting off 3t. So there you go. That big old fraction is precisely the one above. So it's the same limit. Let's keep on going. What cancellation do we get? There's 20t squared minus 20t squared. There's a 3t minus 3t. And now at this point, we can factor out an h. So we'll end up with 40t coming from this term. We'll end up with 20h coming from this term right there, the 20h squared. And then the only other term left is the 3h. And if we take an h away from it, it's just 3. So that's what we get, with the h in the denominator. Now, we factored out an h so that we can cancel, so we're just taking the limit of 40t plus 20h plus 3. And remember, it's h that's going to 0. That's really important. T does not depend on h. So as h goes to 0, that term will go to 20 times 0, and then 3 will just go to itself. So that 0 term is irrelevant, the term where we're multiplying by 0. So we just computed that the derivative of position, the velocity function, is given by 40t plus 3. Okay, so that's our answer, right? The velocity of the car, its speed is 40t plus 3. But wait, remember, we're supposed to be answering a particular question. That question was, how fast is the car going at the end of the race? Well, this is telling us the speed at time t. Let's record that here. Really, the velocity, the speed with direction, time t. And the end of the race was after 5 seconds. So to find the velocity at the end of the race, we should plug in t equals 5 seconds. So we get 40 times 5 plus 3. Let's see, that's a 200. So we get 203 as the velocity at the end of the race. Remember, our units were feet and seconds. So that's a speed in feet per second. It's 203 feet per second. That's the velocity at the end of the race. Now, that's not maybe so familiar if you do your unit conversion. I'm not going to show you the math just because we got other things to do. But if you convert feet to miles and you convert the seconds to hours, this ends up being about 138.409 miles per hour. That's awful fast. That's a speedy little car there by the end of the race. It's going about 138 miles an hour.